our guest, Charlie Spiering. Welcome to the program.
Hey, Reg. Thanks for having me.
You bet. So let's talk a little bit about the why, right? The why of why you wrote the book. Of course, we need a comprehensive examination of Kamala Harris, as I like to call her, because, you know, people look at her. She is the sitting vice president. But what was the impetus for you to dig into this topic?
Well, there's been a lot of Biden books, you know, but when you're looking at the future, you cannot look at the future without thinking of the possibility of a possible president, Kamala Harris. If Biden wins re-election and doesn't make it through the next 4 years, she could very well be the next president. So maybe it's time for Americans to understand exactly what they're getting when they go to the polls in 2024, because it's a very real possibility that she might be your next president without even having to run an election on her own.
Right. And that's the scary part, right? That whole one heartbeat away from the Oval Office. Now, let's talk about how she struggled in the early years of being vice president with all of the difficulty she faced. She couldn't get a thought out right. She still can't in many ways. Everything comes out kind of jumbled, and she became the border czar, and that seems to have gone by the wayside. And it seemed like she just didn't get along with Biden, or at least with Dr. Joe Biden. What can you tell us about any of that?
Yeah, so I dug into her existing relationship with Biden, with the Biden family, certainly the Biden family, especially Jill, you know, maybe willing to forgive Kamala Harris for all the attacks against Joe during the election season. But she's not going to forget it, and she's certainly not going out of her way to build this warm relationship with Kamala Harris. And Team Biden feels the same way. They're not there to help her out or make her look good. They see her as a tool that they will need to win re-election, but they certainly aren't trying to help her beyond their current needs. They're not there to help her boost her political career. They believe that she is there to help Joe Biden, and that's it.
Now, I know that I've seen reports and I've heard commentary that, again, the Bidens were kind of difficult with her. You're saying they're cordial, or are they putting her on ice?
Well, I mean, it's just like politicians in Washington, right? In public, they're very warm and praising, but behind the scenes, they are very much putting her on ice. They're not giving her anything that they trust. You know, they don't trust her to handle any serious issues for the president. They would rather keep her in the background and only pull her out to, you know, go out to women, to young people, to, you know, leftist activists, and especially to stoke any sort of racial controversy. They love pulling her out for that. And that's kind of what she's been diminished. Her role is sort of shoehorned into these small categories, which kind of happens with a lot of minority Democrats. They find themselves just being servants of the ultimate, you know, the ultimate power center, which is currently right now Joe Biden.
Yeah. And you know, what's interesting is I don't think it's limited just to the Biden family, because I saw an interview that Nancy Pelosi gave to Anderson Cooper, and he said she seems well positioned to be the best possible running mate. And Nancy Pelosi's answer was, I mean, it was just shocking to me. She said, well, she's very good at what she does. And I wish I had the audio to play it for you, but it was very embarrassing.
What a great clip to remember. It was
right.
So shocking.
That?
The most powerful woman in American politics, arguably the most powerful woman in American politics, won't endorse the first female vice president for re-election. That goes to show you she knows, as a California politician, she knows exactly what's wrong with Kamala Harris, but she won't say it out of politeness. But she certainly isn't going out of her way to endorse her. That weird phrase she replied, well, Joe thinks she is, so
right.
That's good enough.
He
for
said,
me,
is she the best
like
person?
That.
And she said, well, he thinks she is. I couldn't believe that. What an insult. So it
and it's
seems
not
like,
just Pelosi. It's Hillary Clinton. It's all the women in politics. They are not proud of her. And what was surprising about what I reported in this book,
yeah,
you people, few Democrats in Washington like her at all. They are not happy with her. They don't like her. They don't like how she works, how she operates. And yeah, that's just the way Washington works. When you're found wanting her, if you have faults, they're going to just sort of quietly push you aside.
Unbelievable. Folks, we're on with Charlie Spiering. He is the author of Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House. The book goes on sale soon. You can get it wherever you get your books. Pre-order it on Amazon if you can. And we're going to come back. We're going to continue our discussion about Kamala Harris. We're going to hear a little bit of a history of her competitive background with Gavin Newsom going back into her career in California with the Democrats. And a couple of more things about her relationship with Willie Brown that are documented in the book. And, of course, we're going to talk a little bit about her use of Black Lives Matter. Don't go anywhere.
This is America at Night with Rich Valdes. Call now, 833-4-VALDES. That's 833-482-5337. 833-4-VALDES. That's Valdes with an S.
Listen to you, Rich, all the time.
America at Night with Rich Valdes.
Isn't Kamala Harris the best running mate for this president?
He thinks so, and that's what matters. And by the way,
you think so?
She's very politically astute. I don't think people give her enough credit. She is, of course, values-based, consistent with the president's values and the rest. And people don't understand. She's politically astute. Why would she be vice president if she were not?
But do you think she is the best running mate, though?
She's the vice president of the United States. So when people say to me, well, why isn't she doing this or that? I said, because she's the vice president. That's the job description. You don't do that much. Mm. You know, you're a source of strength, inspiration, intellectual resource, and the rest. And you, and she, I think she's represented our country very well at home.
Nancy Pelosi throwing Kamala Harris under the bus and ever so eloquently backing it up and driving her over again. That's great. Our guest is Charlie Spiering. He's written the book on Kamala Harris called Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House. I like to call her Kamala Harris. And Charlie Spiering, welcome back. I want to continue our discussion on why it's not just Pelosi, not just the Biden family, but so many that are just looking at Kamala Harris with disdain. And a lot of this goes back to her very competitive history with Gavin Newsom. Tell us more about that.
Yeah, you're looking at two ambitious proteges of Willie Brown in San Francisco. You know, Willie Brown is one of the most powerful political forces in California ever. And, you know, these were both proteges. Gavin Newsom became mayor. She became district attorney. And their careers have sort of blossomed in liberal California over the years, you know, fueled by the rich and the wealthy and the elites and the powerful. And they were sort of both sort of pushing each other's buttons, kind of frenemies. By 2016, these two ambitious politicians were both kind of eyeing the governor position. And then all of a sudden, Barbara Boxer steps down in 2016, opening up another slot. So Newsom ended up running for governor. Harris ended up running for Senate. And so fortunately, they avoided what all of their supporters were expecting to be a massive collision. But they sort of avoided that with Barbara Boxer stepping back. And the rest is history. Kamala Harris ran and won for Senate. Gavin Newsom is now the governor of California. And wow, look, they're both on the national stage again and eyeing the presidency as their next step in their career.
And, you know, I find it fascinating that this Willie Brown had so much, gravitas with these people. He's such an influencer. How did their paths cross?
Well, Willie Brown, you know, one of the most powerful people in California, was a political mentor to lots of different California politicians. But he only dated one of them. I think just one of them. I'm sure he had some sort of relationships with others, but the only one that we know of and the only serious relationship he had with one of his proteges was Kamala Harris. They met in right as he was running for mayor of San Francisco. And, you know, even though Kamala Harris was 29, half his age, Brown was then 60, they dated for about a year at the same time Brown was running for mayor. And, you know, was it true love or was it kind of an advantageous relationship? Was it one based on politics and identity? Well, we know for a fact that Brown had no problem mixing the two. And so, yeah, Willie Brown helped her career, but he also did a lot more for her.
And in the book, and we don't have a lot of time, but as concise as you could be, because I think this is an interesting point here. What's the story behind Kamala Harris's parents being part of an intellectual group that admired and promoted black nationalism?
Yeah, her parents, when they were at Berkeley, they were members of this Afro-American intellectual group in San Francisco. Kind of the source of the black nationalist movement, black Marxists. You remember cited Castro and Chairman Mao as sort of their heroes. Her father was described as a Marxist scholar when he taught at Stanford. So there was very much a big intellectual Marxist bend with her and her family at this point. Now, eventually her parents separated, but this was very much the sort of atmosphere that she began her life in.
Outstanding. Now, Charlie Spiering, I want you to let everybody know how they get a copy of the book, the best way to pre-order the book. And well, let's start with that.
Yeah, it's available wherever books are sold as a pre-order. You know, a lot of people use Amazon these days. It's there as a pre-order. Order it now. It'll show up on your doorstep on Tuesday.
Outstanding. And once they've pre-ordered and bought a copy for themselves and one to give away to somebody else, how do they follow you on social media and keep in touch with all the great work you're doing?
Yeah, follow me at Charlie Spiering on Twitter, or I guess it's X now. And then anywhere, I'm also Charlie Spiering on Facebook and Instagram. So, yeah, I look forward to I'm really grateful to be able to reach out to your audience. I can't tell you the amount of times I've been driving in the car late at night, flip on the radio and listen to your voice. So really appreciate the chance to talk to you and your audience.
It's my pleasure, and thank you. I appreciate you listening to the show, and I wish you the best of luck with the book. And it really looks like a fantastic book. I mean, you talk about a lot of really interesting things about her career as a prosecutor, and just a lot of interesting stories that, you know, we haven't heard, and some that we may have heard only a little bit about, where you kind of unearth the whole background behind it. So, folks, get a copy of the book. Charlie Spiering is the author. The book is Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House. It's on sale January 23rd. Go to Amazon. I always say get a copy for yourself, one for somebody else that could benefit from a really good read. So get two copies at a minimum. Again, Amateur Hour is the book, and you're going to learn all about que mala eres, which is how bad she is in Spanish, Vice President Kamala Harris. Charlie Spiering, you are a gentleman, a scholar, and a patriot, and I want to thank you for being here with us tonight.
Thanks so much, Rich. Great to
you
be
bet.
On.
Likewise. All right, folks, straight ahead, we're going to talk about cyber attacks, what to do in the event of a cyber attack. I know people don't typically